And I'm Dave Jones with another segment on how GOES-R is benefiting observations. This one is called Benefits of Improved Observations and how GOES-R will contribute to a lot of disasters that we're seeing. It'll contribute to the monitoring of those disasters and evolution. So first of all, GOES-R is scheduled to launch in early 2016. And when that launch happens, there is a period of time where it has to go through checkout, validation and verification of the sensors and all that sort of stuff. So we should be seeing GOES-R data about 4 to 6 months after the actual launch appears. So what I'd like to do is just back out a little bit and just give you a little understanding, hopefully, of the number of disasters that we see around the country and around the world. Focusing on our nation, on the United States, we've seen an increase in the number of billion-dollar disasters since 1980. As a matter of fact, take a look around the coastline here in Texas and in Mississippi and Alabama, North Carolina. We've had between 26 and 35 $1 billion disasters since 1980. And it's a combination of a couple of things. People are moving closer to the coastline. People are moving into cities and making those populations larger. So it may not be that we're just having a whole string of huge billion-dollar disasters on their own. We're really moving into the way of these disasters. So we're moving into a location where disasters are becoming more prevalent, such as along the coastline. So you can see that billion-dollar disasters happen in every state, even in the upper Midwest and in Michigan and Wisconsin. Not as many, but they still do exist. We've had in 2013 a number of tornadoes. As a matter of fact, those tornadoes have affected populated areas. Severe weather, extreme weather has affected populated areas. And this particular map itself shows the change in population since 1980. And what's really interesting is if I zoom right into places like the desert Southwest, Las Vegas, they've seen a population increase of nearly 300% since 1980. Now that's putting a lot of people in areas where water resources are scarce and also where drought is prevalent. And so if I move across, any of these counties that you see with colors in them have had increases in population since 1980. Not necessarily 300%, but look at Florida. There are some counties that have been about 200% increase in population. So when we take these populations and put them along the coastline, it increases the vulnerabilities to these sort of disasters. So what I'd like to show you regarding severe weather, extreme weather, tornadoes, is that in 2013, we've had an increase in the number of tornadoes in sort of like off months, January, October, November, December. We've seen an increase in the number of tornadoes. Take a look at 2013. We had one event where we had over 300 tornadoes. And in another event in the same month, I think it was the same week, just a bit less than 450 tornadoes in one single event. So we have the typical peak of severe weather season in the springtime and early summer. And then look at this. We seem to have another peak in the amount of severe weather and tornadoes in October, November, December. Look at this. One day in November, we had more than 600 tornadoes. What does this tell us? It tells us that tornadoes can happen at any day, any time, and any month of the year. And that's why we need improved observations so we can have more timely observations, higher resolution observations, and we can have observations that can be fed into numerical prediction models so we can have more accurate forecast models. So I want to show you what it looks like when we talk about emissions of carbon into the atmosphere. This particular visualization shows what the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, has predicted by the middle to the end part of this century if the existing carbon emissions continue at the same rate that they're happening today and increase at the same rate that they've been on as far as a trend is concerned. So remember I showed you the population? I want to show you what it looks like by what the predictions are, one of the possibilities for the number of 90 degree days across the nation and what it may look like by the middle to end part of the century. I'll wipe off the population and take a look at this. Over here is the legend. So we're talking about areas in this orange to pink to darker pink, more than 180 days of expected 90 degree temperatures or higher. So anywhere you see it a little darker color, like in Florida, South Texas, Central Texas, the desert Southwest, including Las Vegas, we see expected temperatures of 90 degrees or higher more than half the days of the year. So what does this mean? We know it's always hot in the South. We know it's hot in Texas. We know it's hot in Florida. We know it's hot in the Southwest. But really, 180 days out of the year seeing 90 degrees or higher? What this is going to do is it's going to change the way in which the retirement patterns in this country are taken. So people may not retire anymore to Florida. They may retire to South Carolina, North Carolina. They may not retire to Texas or South Texas anymore. They may instead go to Colorado or places further north. And in the desert Southwest, the same thing. It won't be a place of retirement anymore because it's just too unbearable. This is why we need more frequent observations. This is why we need the GOES-R system in the atmosphere, above the atmosphere in space, orbiting, keeping a constant eye on what's happening with regard to the weather, the land, and the environment. So what I want to do here now is go and talk a little bit about trends in drought. We've seen between 1958 and 2007 a trend in the amount of drought. So if you see a darker color, it's increasing drought. If you see a lighter color, it's decreasing drought. So what we see in the Northeast is increasing, decreasing drought in the Southeast, decreasing drought in the Northeast, increasing drought in the Southeast, because we're seeing a lack of rainfall, and we're also seeing a lowering of the water reservoirs underneath in the aquifers. And so this color in blue, where we've seen decreasing drought between 1958 and 2007, also means we've seen a change over the last couple of years that this is going more towards increasing drought. We have a tremendous drought going on right now here in early 2014 in the West because of a lack of snowfall. Now, what I'd like to do is show you this particular image as well, which is a comparison using the NASA MODIS sensor on the Aqua and Terra satellites, what the increasing, what the snow cover looked like in 2013 out towards the Sierra Nevada range and out towards the western part of the U.S. There was a lot of snow on the ground, a lot of snowpack, and that snow provides one-third of the drinking water for people in California. Take a look at January 2014, what the snowpack was. Just a few weeks ago, here we are in February of 2014, hardly any snow has fallen because of a huge dome of high pressure that has kept the moisture out of that area. And this is a serious problem. We'll see that problem increasing as time goes on. So these kind of maps and this information displayed in geographic information systems really help us understand what's happening and how we can take GOES-R data and put it in. Now, I'd like to show you this particular time-lapse image, which is an example of when it snows harder. When it rains harder because of an increasing amount of moisture in the atmosphere. This is a time-lapse image and movie of a snowstorm in the Northeast U.S. This particular place, I believe, is in New Hampshire. But take a look at just how rapidly the snowfall accumulates after only about a 20-hour period. So this is close to 4 feet of snow in a 20-hour period. So we actually have, in this particular map, sort of verification that that area has seen an increase in the number of days with heavy precipitation of 51 to 60%. So we're seeing an increase in precip here, not as much of an increase, but overall in heavier amounts. So what that means, if you think about it, is heavier amounts of precipitation in a shorter period of time could mean flash flooding, could mean serious implications for getting people out of harm's way, which is why we need to have more observations in a higher time frequency, like from GOES-R. We'll have imagery every 5 minutes, we'll have imagery every minute if needed, and imagery every 30 seconds if needed when it goes into rapid scan operations. So that's what's going on as far as that's concerned with drought and monitoring. We also are concerned with sea level rise from different satellite missions. The TOPEX mission, JASON mission, JASON 2 mission, we've seen an increase in sea levels, rate of change of about 3.2 or so millimeters per year, but we are seeing that rate increase because of rapid melting going on in other parts of the world, including Greenland. So we see sea level rise that's overlaid onto the population map. So I can wipe on and off the population map where the sea level is impacting along the coastline. So in Louisiana, we have a serious impact. As a matter of fact, I can go a little bit closer in the mid-Atlantic just to show you with populations how they'll be impacted by a 1 meter sea level rise. If I get a little bit closer here, you can see eastern parts of North Carolina with a sea level rise of just 1 meter, that's 3 feet, really seriously impacting places where people live. So I'm going to back out a little bit, dive down into New Jersey. This is a visualization of what a 1 meter sea level rise looks like and how it impacts Atlantic City, New Jersey. So there's a lot of people that live here. There are a lot of people that vacation here. And take a look when I wipe on the 1 meter sea level rise, the impacts that it will have on people and existing infrastructure. So when you're thinking about the built environment, we need better observations, we need more observations, we need observations in a timely fashion that can help communicate to people their risk. And that's what GOES-R is all about, helping to increase the communication of risk into decision support systems and into decision support environments. So I'm going to back out here and show you another thing, I'll switch gears a little bit, volcanoes. Why do we care about volcanoes? Well, I can tell you that when a volcano erupts, we have volcanic ash that goes up high into the sky. As a matter of fact, in this picture here, it's a picture of an erupting volcano, you do not want to fly through a volcanic ash cloud. That will liquefy in an airplane's engine, and then it will solidify and then bring that airplane down. So it's very critical to avoid volcanoes when you're flying. So this particular visualization here shows some volcanoes along the Central American coastline. And I want to show you a satellite image, which is a proxy GOES-R image. This is of an erupting volcano. This is from the MODIS sensor. And so what this will enable you to do is enable decision makers to highlight where they see the volcanic ash cloud. If they see it here and they want to collaborate with other volcanic ash advisory centers, another volcanic ash advisory center might say, well, listen, we also see ash out in this area, and we also see ash out in this area too. So collaboratively determining where they want to issue advisories, they can take both of them into account and say, you know what, we want to make this area sort of a no-fly zone for the next 3 hours, and then update that as we get updated imagery from GOES-R every 5 minutes, every 1 minute if needed. So GOES-R is going to be able to really analyze and observe rapidly changing environmental conditions when it relates to volcanoes and other phenomena in the atmosphere. So this last image I'm going to leave you with is an image of Sandy, Hurricane Sandy, as it was off the coast of North Carolina. And Hurricane Sandy at this particular point was still a hurricane. This is the official National Hurricane Center forecast track. Now, with GOES-R and improved images and in resolution and time, we'll be able to focus in on exactly what's going on with storms like this. As it moves up to the north, what's going to be the impact as it changes? And it'll give National Weather Service meteorologists, other meteorologists in the private sector, and other decision makers much more information in a shorter period of time, so they can make decisions on whether they want to evacuate or whether they want to stay put and what's the impact going to be. So hurricanes in the Atlantic Basin are not necessarily increasing in frequency, but an increase in the sea surface temperatures may be leading to more intense hurricanes as we move forward in time. And that's what's being found here. Hurricanes in the Atlantic Basin, no clear trend in the numbers. Hurricane strength has increased since the 1980s, and the intensity of the strongest hurricanes is projected to increase as the ocean continues to warm. So all of these observation platforms that are going to be launched up in GOES-R are going to be critical for giving scientists and forecasters the information that they need to really pass on decision support services to emergency managers and others. And this particular image is a high-resolution image of Atlantic City, New Jersey. I wanted to show you real quick what happens when you replenish a beach 5 to 6 months before Hurricane Sandy. Right here is a pipeline coming from the Army Corps of Engineers that's replenishing the beach. And we actually have a bulldozer that's pushing sand up onto the beach. And I'll get a little bit closer here and show you what it looks like 2 days after Hurricane Sandy hits. So this is 6 months before, and this is 2 days after. So you can see the water is churned up. There's been a lot of coastal erosion that's happened. This is a cliff where the ocean has taken away a lot of that sand that was built up from the Army Corps of Engineers in Atlantic City at the cost of multiple millions of dollars. So the Army Corps has to come back. And that's what they're doing, is replenishing the beach again because of this serious storm called Sandy that made landfall. So in this era of improved observations, GOES-R is going to be a significant contributor to helping us improve weather observation, weather forecasting, environmental observation, and improving our environmental intelligence around the world. So from Atlanta and the AMS show, I'm meteorologist Dave Jones.